It's a game I've been afraid to analyze for years. I'm still scared. It's probably the most difficult, complicated game you've ever seen in your life. 1957, Tal versus Koblents. E4, C5, Sicilian defense. Knight F3, D6, D4, C, D, Knight takes D4, Knight F6, Knight C3. The most common move we encounter here is the A6 Nadorf variant. In the game, Koblents' choice was the C6 continuation. So, his control of the crucial central E5 square was increased, and he did not leave his opponent's very strong center knight alone. With the bishop G5, Tal continues to play with the development of a fast queenside. If bishop F6 is allowed, there is also an intention to weaken the pawn structure. That's why Koblents played e6, ensuring the queen's support for the knight. Queen d2. Richter-Rauser variation. Tal will soon make queenside castling and try to attack from his opponent's kingside. Koblents continued his development with the bishop e7. He unpinned his knight. Queenside castling and kingside castling. So the castlings were made on the opposite side. There is an important question that should be answered. Who will be the first to reach the opposing king? We'll see. Guys, Tal's choice here is knight b3. Yes, it appears to be a loss of tempo and a retreat at first glance. Tal, on the other hand, had very good reasons for doing so. When we remember the Korchnoi-Geller game, Korchnoi's choice was f4. Which was quite natural. By increasing the space advantage from the center and the king side. And our basic plan here was to play queen a5. However, if this was done directly, after the knight b3 counterattack, the queen could easily be removed from the a5 square, where it was very happy. So, first, knight takes d4. And after queen takes d4, queen a5 can be easily played. So what are the benefits of queen a5? Let's remember that briefly. First, he has increased his central control from the fifth horizontal and can help his own king side in defense. Also, to protect the d6 pawn, he opened the d8 square, and with the rook d8, this pawn's protection may be increased. And we can see that the opponent is putting a lot of pressure on the queen side, where the king is. Is it over? No. The queen on the a5 will support b5 advances from the queen side at a convenient moment. And now, the c vertical is open. Because there is no longer a knight on square c6, the queen's bishop can move here to put pressure on his opponent's highly sensitive central e4 pawn. So, queen a5 is a versatile, functional, and useful move. But keep in mind that after the kingside castling, Koblents wanted to pursue this plan if his opponent allowed it. Because if this queen a5 continuation is played without kingside castling, in the sample variants we just examined, the bishop b5 check can be a bit annoying. So we understand that the timing of the knight takes d4 move must be very well planned. We should think about asking a question after all of this. Sure, we understand that Tal wants to block the knight takes d4 move. Because it is a general principle that the player who is playing in a narrow space wants to relax by exchanging pieces, and the knight takes d4 move serves to accomplish this. If Tal didn't want that, why didn't he play knight b5 instead of knight b3? Because, as this knight moved a much more active square, it once again prevented exchanges and demanded the d6 pawn. It appears that this pawn cannot be protected. But here again, the opponent could play queen a5. And there are actually tactical defenses here. Against knight takes d6, since there could always be the ideas of pin with rook d8, it wouldn't be easy to take this pawn. That's why, against kingside castling, Tal played knight b3. he blocked his opponent's desire to relax by exchanging pieces. He's kept more pieces on the board and opened the d vertical, putting more pressure on the d6 pawn. And now, Koblents continues the game with queen b6. In fact, it's a tactical move to protect the d6 pawn. If we play bishop takes f6 here, what's our plan? This bishop is the only piece that protects the d6, and because the opponent does not want the pawns in front of his king to weaken, the opponent will capture with the bishop takes f6. If we take the pawn with the queen takes d6 move, there is a continuation, such as the opponent's rook d8. He can simply take the pawn in f2, or, most logically and effectively, the bishops could weaken the pawn structure in front of our king after c3. That's why trying to take this pawn after queen b6 is not a good plan. Tal didn't do that either. Against queen b6, he continued to play with f3. Now he wants to launch a wing attack. He strengthened his center. That's very important. But it wasn't about protecting the pawn. It was about being able to support the g4 pawn advance from the king's side. f3 versus a6. As we said before, now the idea of knight b5 is off the table. And when the queen leaves the b6 square, Koblents has prepared the b5 advances from the queen's side to reach the opposing king. And while Tal continued to play with the g4, rook d8. Now that the d6 pawn is protected, the king can relax a bit. And here, with bishop e3, Tal demanded from his opponent's queen, and Koblents withdrew his queen to square c7. Yes, Koblents also played queen b6, now queen c7. It appears that he lost tempo, but it's difficult to say for sure. Because Tal just played with his knight one more time, and now he's playing with his bishop again. But it's fair to say that after h4, Tal's attack is coming much faster. And Koblents launched an attack from the queen's side with b5, and now g5, knight d7, g6. It's a very strong move. What did we say? When attacking the opposing king, time is of the essence. And now, if allowed, Tal wants to open the G vertical so that he can go to the opposing king after the captures. That's why Koblents played H takes G6 and Tal played H5. That was the idea. After G takes H5, Rook takes H5. Tal made a very significant progression in his position. He opened the H vertical, but Koblents moved his knight back to square F6 and demanded the rook. When Tal made Rook H1, look. There is a very important demand, such as queen h2, and it may come with a checkmate demand. Seeing this, Koblents played d5 and blocked the queen h2, because, what do we know so well? We're not going to exchange queens when we're attacking. And with e5, Tal is blocking the way of queen to h2, another pawn sacrifice. Alright, this pawn is undefended. Can't it be taken? First, if it is taken with the queen in order to prevent queen h2, the queen will be captured. After bishop f4, there's only one square it can go, which is bishop f5, and after bishop d3, you would lose the queen. That's why e5 has to be taken with knight. But Tal played f4 first. He considered pinning the knight so that after queen h2, he could demand the knight along with a checkmate. But it's not that easy. With knight d6, Koblents also increased the support of his knight and got out of the pin. Now with queen h2, Tal wants a mate in one move, but it's blocked with king f8. Against queen h8, knight g8. Yes, it's a bit of a passive defense, but Koblents' argument is that first I can defend one king safely, then I can easily focus on my own attack from the other wing. But Tal doesn't stop. Rook h7. give the g7. And there isn't much of a choice here. Koblents played f5. He opened the queen's horizontal, protecting the g7 pawn from the 7th horizontal. Tal continued the pressure. Bishop h6. Of course, the knight can't take the bishop because it's in a pin, and the pawn also can't take it because the queen is undefended. Koblents played rook d7 here, protecting the g7 pawn. Please remember, right now, the most critical point of the game, of the board, is the pawn in the g7 square. If this pawn is captured, the game is over. And here comes a perfect sacrifice from Mikhail Tal. Bishop takes b5. The basic idea is to be able to open the first horizontal quickly and bring the rook to the attack. But a lot of calculations had to be made here. Like what? Let's take a quick look. First of all, if this bishop sacrifice is accepted, there'd be knight takes b5. Why is that so strong? Because, as we just said, the g7 pawn is very important, and there's a rook and a queen attached to the defense of this pawn. At the same time, these are dependent on the bishop's protection in d6. The knight then demanded the queen. It's not something we want. Well, against bishop takes b5, it's not a good choice to take the bishop. We simply demanded the rook. Simultaneously, one of the ideas behind the latest rook d7 move was to unpin the queen. And what happens this time when the g takes h6 move is made? It would be countered by the bishop takes d7 first. The g vertical would then open, putting a lot of pressure on the rook g1 and the knight in the pin. That's not good either. And against the bishop takes b5, did you see that? Tal's queen attacks beautifully in square h8, but it can't move anywhere. It's stuck. So, with the knight g6, it appears that Tal's queen is about to be lost. But Tal has planned this as well, and I'm pretty sure he calculated the knight d4 the machine suggested. Look what knight d4 is doing. It's counterattacking with knight takes e6 and demands the opposing queen. And Koblents could have said, I'll play rook e7. For now, let me calmly protect my e6 pawn. Your queen isn't going anywhere and can't escape anyway. I can capture it easily. It's not that easy. First, the machine suggests the bishop takes g7 sacrifice. When the rook takes g7 is made, it suggests bishop d7. What does the bishop d7 want? It blocked the bishop's view of e6. It wants to capture the queen again with knight takes e6. So, what happens if play bishop takes d7? This time, the queen's connection to the rook would be severed, and the rook would be lost. Well, then I won't take it with the bishop, but I'll take it with the queen. Now what? Knight takes e6, a diversion tactic. When the queen is taken again, the rook is undefended. So guys, let's pretend we didn't see this one. It's pretty complicated. We'll go back to Tal's bishop takes b5 sacrifice. Koblents calculated that and played rook f7. He escaped his rook, and Tal is playing rook g1. And beware, he both blocked the ideas of the knight g6 and the g takes h6. Because the knight in the back would be undefended and mated. We demanded with our fourth piece, rook g1. That's why Koblents kept defending the g7 with rook a7. And with knight d4, Tal has now continued the game by centralizing his most passive piece. A brief reminder again, if the undefended bishop is taken, knight takes b5. It'll be too strong again. Give the queen, rook, and bishop. Therefore, this bishop cannot be touched at this time. And here, Koblents finds such a beautiful defense. So he now appears to be passively defending, but he made the knight g4 sacrifice. I mean, to close the g vertical. Look, with the f takes g4, now that the g vertical is closed, the bishop's capture is possible because the knight is not on demand, but it can't happen right away. Against g takes h6, there is g takes f5. We can open the g vertical and attack the knight in the pin again. But Koblents' idea was to move his bishop to the e5 square. What's the idea of that? He demands the knight with tempo, and now, the g takes h6 move will demand the queen. What does Tal do when he notices this? He plays knight c6 by disturbing the bishop that created this demand. So, what did Koblents do? He played bishop takes c3. And what do you think Tal did? He took this bishop here? Of course not. Guys, this isn't a normal game. Our brains are on fire now. Against bishop takes c3, Tal played bishop e3. He blocked his opponent's g takes h6 moves. And there is a bishop c5 check threat with no good defense. So the game could end quickly. Koblents blocked it with d4, and he demanded the bishop. And what did Tal do? He withdrew his bishop? No. He played rook gh1. What's the demand? A queen sacrifice with queen takes g8 and mate with rook h8. Koblents sees that. He played rook d7 by opening the f7 square for his king to prevent the checkmate. What's Tal doing now? This bishop is crucial in an attack, and he moved it to the only available square, the g5. Tal is attempting to keep the bishop in the game. Now what do you think Koblents did? He took the undefended bishop, a takes b5. Tal's king is now very weak, and Tal only shows us one of his ideas, which is to withdraw his bishop to h6 with rook 1h6. Rook joined the attack as well. Can't this rook be taken? Against g takes h6, the bishop takes h6 move has now a check threat. Of course, the king can't escape because the knight is undefended. It would be checkmate. You'd have to deal with a bad pin with the rook g7, and the bishop takes g7 move can also be made here, after which the bishop is taken. That means the game has come to an end. That is why you are unable to take the rook against rook 1h6. So, what did Koblents do? He played d3. He said, if you take my pawn, the c vertical will open. I'll take the knight, and there would be a discovered threat. So what did Tal do? He played b takes c3 to keep the c vertical closed. d2 check, king d1, and queen takes c6. Tal has also left the knight. But I can hear you wondering what might happen. Guys, here, with rook f6, Tal manages to find the perfect move. Here is the rook h6's trick. Can't this rook be taken? Against g takes f6, bishop h6. The game would end right away. Again, because the knight is undefended, the king cannot escape and you have to leave your rook undefended. So what did Koblents do for the rook f6 move? He can't escape his king. He counterattacked with rook f7. And after Tal's queen takes g7 move, the queen who has been waiting quietly in the corner now takes the finishing shot. And after the queen takes g7, Koblents leaves the game. The rook is in a pin. It can't take the queen. And when the king escapes, take whatever you want. You can have the knight. Or better yet, the rook. It won't make much difference. After the queen takes g7, the game ended. It's the most complicated and difficult to understand game I've ever seen. I hope I've made it clear, but it's not an easy game to understand on the first watch. I believe it should be watched several times. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you enjoyed this video, please like, leave a comment, and subscribe to this channel. And click on the bell icon to stay updated with my new videos. Hope to see you in the next videos. Take care.